All right.
Can you hear me? Is it on? Yeah. So, all right. So last time we discussed very general terms and abstract terms, how to preserve supersymmetry on curved manifolds. And today I would like to start presenting a concrete example. So we see the equation, how they works. And this will be an example in two dimensions. So, okay, we're still discussing supersymmetry on curved manifolds, and I would like to discuss one example, which is two-dimensional theories with 2.2 supersymmetry. And so I will discuss one specific example, of course, different dimensionality, different amount of supersymmetry, different details, so let's pick one. And moreover, this will be the setup where all my other examples will live. So this will be useful later on as well. So on Lorentzian signature, this means, this amount of supersymmetry means that there are, well, two left-moving Majorana vial supercharges and two right-moving. This supersymmetry algebra admits some R-symmetry, which is not a symmetry of the, is not part of the algebra, is an outer automorphism of the algebra. And this maximal R-symmetry that in theory can have is two copies of U1. One is vector-like, one is axial, so one gives the same charge. Well, the vector-like gives charges plus one and minus one, and the axial gives the same charges to the two supercharges. However, this is not part of the supersymmetry algebra, it's just an outer automorphism, and so a supersymmetric theory does not need to have this supersymmetry, this R-symmetry. However, I would like to concentrate on theories that have this R-symmetry. So I require that this R-symmetry is there, and this one is not necessarily there. Might be, but not necessarily. And so if we go to Euclidean, on flat space, the algebra looks like the following. We have momentum. And then it turns out that this supersymmetry algebra admits central charges. In particular, with this R-symmetry, we can have a complex central charge. And, this is in spinor space. So this is momentum. These are the projectors on positive chirality and negative chirality. And here I'm in Euclidean signature, so all the fields are complexified. And in particular, if I was in Lorentzian, this tilde would be a bar, and this would be the complex conjugate of this. But in Euclidean signature, this is not the case. Same thing for the central charges. This would be the complex conjugate of this, but in Euclidean, it's not. And everywhere, I will now use tildes. And you have to remember that tilded quantities are the complex conjugate in Lorentzian, but not in Euclidean. OK. Moreover, we insist on having this, in this example, to having this R-symmetry. And so the supercharges have charges minus 1 and plus 1. There are these central charges. By definition, a central charge is a charge that commutes with the supersymmetries. So the supercharges are not charged under the central charges. All right. So now we want to take these theories and study what happens when we try to put them on a curved manifold. And because we are insisting on the fact that the theory has this vector-like R-symmetry, well, in the theory will exist the R-multiplet. So we don't use the most general S-multiplet, but use this smaller one. And, what is in the R-multiplet in this specific example? Now we can be more concrete. So, of course, there is the stress tensor, there is the supersymmetry current, and its conjugate. And then, well, we have R charge and we have central charge, so we have gauge fields for them. Sorry, we have current operators for them. So there will be R symmetry current, Z and Z tilde. And this is all we have. And, well, of course, stress tensor is conserved, supersymmetric current is conserved, but also these are conserved currents. Okay, so, well, there exists a two-dimensional supergravity with an off-shell formulation which can be coupled to the R-multiple. This is essentially the dimensional reduction of minimal supergravity, new minimal supergravity in four dimensions. And what the supergravity, so the supergravity contains a gravity multiplet. And what is in this gravity multiplet? Well, we have, of course, the metric. We have, of course, the gravitino and its conjugate. And then here we have conserved currents. So here we have, in fact, gauge fields. So a gauge field is coupled to the R symmetry. Gauge fields that couples to these central charges. And here I'm using some notation in which, well, this is a real vector field, but C and C tilde are complex because the central charge is complex. We could just divide them into the real and imaginary part, and the same thing for these currents. Okay, so where do these auxiliary fields appear? Well, of course, they appear in all covariant derivatives. So, for instance, if we have a generic field phi, some R charge, some central charges, and we apply a covariant derivative, this covariant derivative will contain the gauge field multiplied by the R charge. And same thing for the other ones, and since I'm using some complex notation, these terms look a little bit unusual, but one can, again, decompose into a real imaginary part of these charges and gauge fields and get standard expression. Okay, so now the first thing we need is the gravitino variation in the supergravity theory. The gravitino is the only fermionic field in this multiplet, so when we want to impose supersymmetry, the only thing that we set to zero, well, we set to zero the gravitino, and we set to zero the variation of the gravitino.
Can there be any global obstructions to setting it to zero?
Sorry?
Can there be any global obstructions to setting it to zero?
It can be global obstructions. Now, it turns out that in this specific example, there are no. And so on any two-dimensional manifold, it will be possible to preserve supersymmetry. But this is specific for this example. And for instance, if we were studying four-dimensional theories with n equal 1 supersymmetry, we would find obstructions. For instance, in four dimensions, it turns out that only on Hermitian manifolds or squashed spheres one can preserve supersymmetry. But in this specific example, in two dimensions, we will be able to preserve supersymmetry on any manifold. And in fact, this is not a new result. This was already new because we know that exists a topological twist. So we already knew that one can always do the topological twist. And in fact, one thing that we would like to see is to break over the topological twist from this approach. Any other question? So, okay, we need the gravitino variations. And these gravitino variations start in a standard way. And here I have the covariant derivative. Of course, this parameter for supersymmetry transformation only has R charge. In fact, the R charge of this is 1. It's not charged in the central charges because the supercharges do not have, they commute with the central charges. And then,
Well, actually, we had these fields, these complex gauge fields, simu and simu tilde. They have a field strength, and well, it is convenient to, since we are in two dimensions, which can dualize the field strength, and it is convenient to introduce this scalar, which is just the dual to the field strength of C, and likewise this complex conjugate. So in terms of these field strengths, one finds an equation like this. Since the two gravitini are independent in Euclidean, we need to impose both equations. So let me explain. So first of all, these equations depend on two spinor parameters, the parameter for supersymmetry variations. They have R charges 1 and minus 1. And this is why we have, well, minus 1 and plus here. And then, okay, this is a matrix on a spinor space. So here, if you wish, there is an alpha, beta, epsilon, beta. And I'm using a basis in which gamma 3 is 1 minus 1. So we could decompose this matrix into the identity matrix and gamma 3, which is the chirality matrix in two dimensions. Moreover, what these dots represent, well, these are other terms which contain the gravitino. But since we are setting the gravitino to 0, these are automatically zero. Okay. So these are the variation of the gravitino in the full in this full supergravity theory. And so what we would like to do is to find the solutions of these equations. I'm sorry?
Epsilon tilde as a relation with
the in Lorentzian signature, this is the complex conjugate. But I'm not, and so it's independent. And this is why I have to impose the two equations separately. Otherwise, you know, no Lorentzian, I would just impose this one.
So H tilde is not the complex conjugate.
Again, same thing. Yeah. All my tilded quantities will be the complex conjugate in Lorentzian, but are independent in Euclidean. All right. And okay, before going to solving this equation, let me also write down what is the deform supersymmetry algebra that one obtains in general terms. So one obtains something like the following. So again, these variations are the composition of the fermions with the supercharges. So I'm using somehow a compact notation. So the first term is a Lie derivative, which is gauge invariant. Well, and this is why I'm putting this A here. It is a Lie derivative along a vector field. And one can show with these equations, it's not hard to do, acting with the covariant derivative. This is a killing vector, in fact. So in particular, this represents an isometry of the manifold, and of course can exist only on two manifolds that can have some isometries, in particular genus 0 and 1 at most. And then there is a correction, deformation. Again, if this is just another way of rewriting the momentum, this derivative represents momentum, represents translation along this killing vector. So this is what we will have on flat space. Well, we have a correction where this, again, this Q is a matrix in spinor space, which looks like the following. So it depends on the central charges, it depends on the R charges, it depends on the background that this field H will take. And as we said, in general, this is linear in the auxiliary fields. So the deformation is linear. And well, we also have so if we take two spinors with the same arc charge, we get zero, and the same thing for the tilted ones. Okay. So, so at this point, we could start studying what is the more general solution of these equations. I don't want to do that. You can go to some references, to the references that I gave you yesterday. I just want to point out some key solutions that will be important for us later. So actually, let me erase here, since I want to keep the equations there. So we want to discuss solutions, so let's take a compact. So first of all, let's take some compact orientable and smooth Riemann surface sigma with some genus. So we are not putting any boundary here. So what solution can we find? So the first solution that we can find on any manifold, any sigma and any metric, it's very simple. So we turn on a background for the gauge field that couples to the R symmetry. It's just a half of the spin connection. And then we take spinors, which are chiral. And constant. And then we set these other fields to zero.
And that switch means it's Laplacian.
Sorry?
You mentioned it's any metric.
Yeah? Yes, so you can choose any metric you want, in particular any spin connection you want. And I'm saying if you plug in this in this in the equation, this will be a solution to these equations. Yes, in fact, this will be the topological twist. This is the topological twist. I mean, it doesn't mean that the theory is topological. It's just telling you that you can preserve supersymmetry with any metric. But it turns out that this is the topological twist. And the resulting theory, if you do this BRST procedure that we describe, and we will, I will talk about again about that example, the theory will become topological. Now, why this is a solution? Well, this is very easy to see. So first of all, these guys are zero, so this doesn't matter. We only have the covariant derivative. And we have this background for the R symmetry. And now, well, we are in two dimensions. So the spin connection is in SO2, which is U1. And so, in fact, the spin connection is just an abelian gauge field. And so, for instance, well, let's take this guy. This has negative chirality. So it's negative charge under spin connection. But it has positive R charge. And so the two things cancel. And so we turn on a background for the R-symmetry that precisely cancels the spin connection. And so what happens is that the covariant derivative on epsilon minus is just equal to the standard derivative on epsilon minus because of this cancellation. In fact, this is a constant. And the same thing for the other guy. This has positive chirality, but negative R charge. So again, the two cancel out, and it's just constant. All right, so this is a very simple solution, has been known for a long time, and this is called A-twist. In these solutions, there are two preserved supercharges. We started with four, we have 2, 2, 2. We can preserve two, so half of it with opposite R charges. And the algebra that we obtain looks like the following. So this anti-commutator, if we specialize the formula that I had before, is zero. And it has to do so because here,
Yes, it's zero, because you remember here, there was the Lie derivative along this Killing vector field. And of course, on a Riemann surface of generic genus, there are no Killing vectors. So it has to be zero.
Okay.
Francesco?
Yes.
I have a question over here.
Oh, yeah.
So in four dimensions, there's this result by Witten that if you have the SE2 twist, that then the theory is topological. Is this the same in two dimensions in these examples?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand the question.
In four dimensions, there's this famous result that if you do the SU2 twist on any manifold, then the theory becomes topological. Is this happening here too?
Yes.
The theory is topological?
I guess this example has been done before, actually. So this is probably the most famous. Anyway, yes, it's the same thing. So in four dimensions as well, you need n equal 2 supersymmetry. And then there is a particular twist. So that means you can turn on a particular vector field that caps to the R symmetry. If you do that, you can preserve supersymmetry on any for any metric and any manifold. And moreover, you can see that the supercharges preserve on a very nice, well, we also have something like this, very nice property that is square to zero. So you can interpret them as a BRST operator. And if you do this interpretation, and so you only regard as physical states and you only look at states that are closed, then the theory is topological. And here is exactly the same thing. Okay, so this solution has been known for a long time. It's the old example. And in fact, for genus G bigger than 1, this is all we have. However, if we take lower genus, there are other solutions. And in particular, I would like to look at the case of the sphere. Again, there are extra solutions for any metric, but let me consider the round metric. And of course, the topological twist exists also on the sphere. However, well, because of this condition here, you see that when you do the topological twist, you have some units of magnetic flux for the R symmetry. In the sense that if you integrate and you ask, OK, let's take the R symmetry flux, this is the field strength, the magnetic flux for the R symmetry. And let's compute the number of units of magnetic flux. This is equal to the spin connection, or the derivative of the spin connection. This is the scalar curvature. And with Gasponet, you get G minus 1. So in particular, there are some number of units of R symmetry flux. And this solution exist on the sphere as well. However, it turns out that on the sphere we have another solution. Which, if you like, is the new solution. In which we don't turn on any R symmetry flux. So let's say again, we are on the round S2. So this is an untwisted solution, an untwisted supersymmetry. And so, okay, there is no flux for the R symmetry. However, we have an expectation value for these fields H and H tilde. And here, R is the radius of the sphere. And if you rewrite the equation that I have before, it looks like the following. And a similar equation for epsilon tilde. Well, let's write it down. So there is no R symmetry flux anymore. This is just standard covariant derivative. We have these two equations. What are these equations? Well, these are the standard Killing spinor equations. And it turns out that each of these equations, which are the same equation, each of them has two solutions of the sphere.
So we get two supercharges from here and two supercharges from here. So in this way, we can preserve actually four supercharges, which is the maximal number, because we started with four, so we cannot preserve more than four. In this particular case. Okay, what is the supersymmetry algebra? Well, in this case, the supersymmetry algebra contains, well, first of all, it will have this Lie derivative. And if we set to zero the central charges for a second, it will contain the R symmetry operator, the R symmetry charge.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
These empty commutators have no reality property, so the right hand side there should be all complex forces. Epsilon, epsilon, tilde, independent spinners.
Yes, it turns out that this combination is constant, but doesn't have to be real. It's not real, so this is not the complex conjugate of this.
The right hand side is not real. But the Lie derivative looks to be real.
Yes. Yes, of course it depends. Yes, so of course it depends what coefficient you put for you choose for epsilon, epsilon, tilde, this is an independent solution of these equations. But if you choose real coefficients, these are real Killing vector fields, Killing vectors. And in fact, what they do, they span the isometry of CO2 of S2. So here the point is the following, that when we go to Euclidean, in principle, also the metric is complexified, as all the other auxiliary fields. So in general, we should discuss also complex metrics. However, this makes things very unclear. And so one would like to restrict to real metrics. And, well, it's maybe not obvious that one can, but in fact, in this case, one can. So you get a real Killing vector field, and which is just the isometry of your sphere. Other questions? Okay, so this is the supersymmetry algebra that one gets, plus the other condition on epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. So there are four supercharges. So what is this super algebra? Well, we already said that here there are the Lie derivatives of SU2. So the super algebra contains an SU2, contains the U1 of the R symmetry, and in fact, what the super algebra is SU2/1. Whose bosonic subgroup is SU2 times U1. And well, this is a subalgebra of the two-dimensional superconformal algebra, and we can call it SU2-1A because it is somehow related to the A-twist. All right, so we looked at these equations. We looked for some specific solutions. There are many more. We found the old solution that we already knew, which is the topological twist, but also we found a new one. And so as we will see, this new one will allow us to obtain some new results. So this concludes what I wanted to say about supersymmetry on co-manifold, and now I would like to move to localization. So if you have other questions on this. Yeah, so the other commutator had the general form epsilon 1, epsilon 2, because there are two. This is 0, and the same thing for the epsilon tilde. Okay, so what I would like to discuss now is this technique called supersymmetric localization, which turns out to be a very powerful technique to exactly compute some path integrals in some favorable circumstances. And as I explained, this technique has been widely used in the past, especially in conjunction with the topological twist, or applied to cohomological or topological theories, which often can be realized as supersymmetric theories topologically twisted. But in fact, is more general, and so we'll see how we can actually apply to more physical supersymmetric theories. Now, it turns out that this technique is somehow an infinite dimensional version of the Duisterman-Heckmann or Atia-Bott-Berlin-Verne localization formula in equivariant cohomology, but instead of starting with the finite dimensional case and then discuss the infinite dimensional version, we will directly jump to the infinite dimensional case and see how it works. So, all right, so suppose that we have some theory with some action, S, and suppose that we have some supercharge that we call Q, and probably before I would have called delta Q, so this is anti-commuting, and well, the theory is supersymmetric, so Q of S is equal to zero, so the action is invariant. Now, this is a fermionic symmetry of the theory, and so if you take the square, this is either zero or might be some bosonic symmetry of the theory. In particular, it would be some translations or some Lorentz rotation or R-symmetry rotations, or if there are some other global symmetries, flavor symmetry will be some flavor symmetry rotation and so on. Now, we are interested in computing the partition function of the theory, which is our path integral, is the integral over all field configurations weighted by the action functional. But instead of computing this quantity here, let me generalize a little bit. So let me compute the following quantity. So I introduce some parameter t. So it is again a path integral. But now I want to add a deformation term, which is Q exact. So it's Q, the Q variation of some other functional. And the only thing that I require is that Q squared of V, which is the same as delta B of V, is equal to zero. So I want that this V is invariant under the bosonic symmetry that I get from this square. And I use it to deform my path integral, and so in general, we'll get a function of T. So let's try to understand what is the dependence on T. So let's compute a derivative. Now when we compute the derivative, we bring down this factor here. It will be a minus However, this is Q closed because the action is invariant, and this is invariant. And so we can actually write this as, okay, let me take this minus out. We can actually write this as Q acting on all the rest. So this is the path integral of something which is Q exact. It's explicitly Q on something else. Now, if the measure is Q invariant, that means that this symmetry Q is non-anomalous, and in particular, this means that also this bosonic symmetry must be non-anomalous. Well, essentially, so what this is the Q transformation of something, and we can do a Fourier definition and reabsorb this Q into the measure, and so this is actually zero. right? Because what this Q represents is the variation with respect to the symmetry of this quantity. We can just do a Fourier definition to absorb this variation, and so this must be zero. So if you wish, a more precise way of saying this is that, this generates a symmetry along a fermionic generation direction in the space of fields. In particular, the space of fields is a supermanifold. And so this generates a translation on the supermanifolds of the fields. And so, well, since this is a translation is a derivative, so essentially what this is a derivative along on field space. And so one can interpret this as a total derivative term. And of course, the integral of a total derivative is zero, unless there are boundary terms. Now, this is a very delicate issue. One has to be careful about these boundary terms. And in fact, there are various examples in which there are boundary terms, and the naive argument that one can do this Fourier definition is zero is wrong. However, if one can make sure that this quantity here, there will be our deformation, goes to infinity as we move in field space, this is our field space, if we make sure that this functional here goes to infinity, then of course this provides an exponential suppression. And so even if there might be boundary terms, they are exponentially suppressed. And so we are sure that, that this is zero. Is this argument clear? Yes.
Positive defined.
Right? Sorry, you have to make sure?
That the QB potential is positive defined.
Not for... Yes, in order to have this argument that goes, this is suppressed. Yes. So if this is the case that it goes to infinity, you don't have these boundary terms. Okay. All right. So this is our crucial result, in the sense that so this shows that actually, even though we thought that there was a dependence on t, when we do this deformation, the answer is independent. So there is no dependence on this path integral on t. Now, what does this imply? So first of all, notice that, of course, the argument is still true if here we insert some operators constructed out of the fields. It can be some local or non-local operators, as long as these operators are Q-closed, so and as long as Q of O equal to zero, the argument still holds. And so, if you wish, this argument shows three things. So first of all, that if in the action there was some term which turns out to be Q exact, so it's the Q variation of something else, then there is no dependence on the path integral on the couplings in front of this action. For instance, suppose that for some reason we are considering some gauge theory. These are super young Mills, the kinetic term for the gauge fields. And suppose that for some reason it turns out that this young Mills action is Q exact, then the path integral will not, this path integral will not depend on the gauge coupling. Secondly, that if we compute expectation values of operators and we change the operator by a Q exact term, so instead of computing the expectation value of O, we compute the expectation value of O plus Q of some other operator P, then the expectation values is the same, because the formation of the operators as the formation of this of the action does not affect this path integral. And moreover, that deforming the action by these terms is not going to change the answer. And we will use this fact at our advantage. Okay, so how can we use this? So before seeing how can we use this, let me make a comment. So I stressed many times that when we go to Euclidean signature, we have to complexify the fields. So somehow the number of fields is doubled. However, now we are computing a path integral, and we don't want to integrate over the complexified fields, because that would be a doubling of the integration directions. We could do that, but first of all, this will not be related to the Lorentzian path integral, and after all, we are interested in understanding, learning something on the Lorentzian theory. Moreover, that path integral in general is not convergent. Instead, what we have to do is that we have to choose a contour, which is a middle dimensional contour, in such a way that the number of integration direction is the same as in Lorentz's signature. And we should make sure that if we integrate along this contour, the path integral is convergent. So in other terms, we have a space of complexified fields where we have both, say, phi and phi tilde, which are independent. But yet, when we do the path integral, we have to select a contour, which is middle dimensional, and we only integrate along this contour. So, okay, so now how can we use at our advantage this fact? So if we take z of 0, this is our original path integral. On the other hand, suppose that we can find some v such that when we compute this qv, and we look at the bosonic part of this qv, this is non-negative along the contour. Then, there is no dependence on t in the path integral. Probably should rewrite it again. So remember, zeta of t was the path integral e to the minus s minus t qv. So since there is no dependence on t, we can take a limit in which t goes to infinity, plus infinity. And then all phi configurations for which the bosonic part of this axial is not 0 is infinitely suppressed. And the only thing that survives are the field configuration for which this is actually 0, that I will call fixed points. So the path integral localizes on a field configuration for which qv is equal to 0. So in a sense, we started with our big path integral, which is on a big space of field configurations. But actually, in this limit, only the neighborhood of some subspace in the space of field configurations where qv is equal to 0 survives. Is this point clear? All right. So now, since the only configuration that survives are the ones around this point, let's try to expand the fields around this locus. Let me parameterize the fields in the following way. So I expand these fields around this locus, phi 0, this configuration for which this is 0. So, well, we can take this functional and expand. So what do we get? So from S, we get S, sorry, there is a T as well. So here we get S of phi 0. Then all the other terms contain some inverse power of T. We are taking the limit T to infinity, and so these are infinitely suppressed. They don't matter. What about this term here? Well, in front of here, we have a T, so we have to be more careful. If we evaluate on phi 0, this is 0. If we look at first order, where this functional is positive, or semi-positive definite, so where it is 0 is a stationary point. So the first order is 0. We only have the second order. In the second order, we have t minus 1 from here, but there is a t here, so they cancel. And so what we have here is qv evaluated second order around these fields of the oscillations, and everything else will be at least of order t to the minus 1/2. Okay, so since we are taking a limit in which t goes to infinity, we can neglect these terms here. But now what do we have here? So what we are left with? Well, we are left with, well, you see, let's look at these oscillations. So the only thing we have is a quadratic action from them. So this is a Gaussian path integral, and we can perform it. And so our z of t, we still have a path integral over this phi 0. We have e to the minus s of phi 0. But we can do the Feynman path integral, and what we get is a superdeterminant of the quadratic expansion of QV at second order around this phi 0. What is a superdeterminant? Well, it's just a ratio between the determinant of the bosonic part and the determinant of the fermionic part. So it's just a standard Gaussian integration formula. The boson goes in the denominator and the fermions in the numerator. But it really is a determinant prime in the sense that if we move the field, so suppose that we still have some moduli space of these fixed points. Of course, if we move in these directions, this function is still zero, and so we will get a zero eigenvalue in this determinant. This is a bosonic zero mode. So what we have to do when we have a bosonic zero mode in the Gaussian path integral, we remove the zero mode and we integrate of the zero mode. So this is what we do here. So this is our final expression. So this is the expression of the path integral in the limit in which t goes to infinity. But since really there is no dependence on t, it's not an approximation, it's the exact value of the path integral at zero, which was our original path integral we wanted to compute. Now, this is still a path integral. So have we gained anything? Well, it really depends what this set of fixed points is. If it turns out that this set of fixed points is finite dimensional, then we are on business, because this path integral, in fact, is a finite dimensional integral. If these are isolated points, we just have to sum over this specific configuration, and we have reduced the path integral to a series. Is this point clear?
So is that just the zero modes, then, that remains? The phi zero, is that only zero modes?
Yes, so by definition, phi zero are the bosonic zero modes of this functional. There might be fermionic zero modes as well. A fermionic zero mode would appear as a zero here. And there are situations in which we also have fermion zero modes, and they have to be treated properly. Either by inserting some operators that contain fermions, and so they can absorb these fermion zero modes, or if this is not the case, one has to expand this action. So if we look at the fermionic part of this action, there are fermions, but because they anti-commute, if you start expanding, this stops at some order. It's not an infinite expansion. So you have to bring down, to expand this action, bring down the first term, and they also can absorb this fermion zero modes.
Can there also be non-trivial instanton contributions in there?
Sorry?
Can there also be non-trivial instanton contributions in there?
Absolutely, yes. So what you are so you have to integrate over the space of configurations on which this is true, but it's not necessarily bosonic configurations. This might be also that some fermions are turned on. And if that is the case, so these are called fermion zero modes. So you turn on a fermion, but really it's not increasing the energy of this, well, the action of this piece. And in general, this path integral is on bosonic and fermion zero modes. In the example that I will show, there will not be fermion zero modes, but in general, there might be, and they have to be treated. OK. So in fact, it turns out that the space or configuration on which we localize are also BPS configurations. And one way to do that is the following. One way to do that is the following. So we can try to make a canonical choice for this V that we use to the form. So let's try to make the following choice. For V, we take a sum of all the fermions in the theory. We take the Q variation of psi. We act on it on some double dagger. psi. So what is this double dagger? Well, double dagger is some antilinear operator that we want to construct in such a way that delta BV is equal to zero. And in such a way that when we act with Q, so if we look at the bosonic part of this, well, this is the sum over the fermions of Q psi, double dagger Q psi. Here, of course, there will be another term in which there is a double Q action here, but this will be a fermionic action because it contains pi epsilon. So this is the bosonic part. And if we can find some operator in this space of complexified fields, which is antilinear, so it's like a dagger, it's complex conjugate on C numbers, but we can choose whatever action we want on the fields. If we can find such an operator such that this is positive definite and it preserves this property, then clearly follows this set in which QV of phi 0 equal to 0 corresponds to the set Q psi is equal to 0. But this set here is precisely the set of BPS configurations. So these are precisely the BPS. Well, we want to find BPS configurations. This is precisely what we impose. We set to 0 the fermions, and we set to 0 the variation of the fermions. So in fact, the patintera localizes on some set of BPS configurations. All right, so this is the general formula, the general mechanism. Let me just make one comment that so the formula that we found, let me write it once again, that our path integral becomes, well, still an integral of the so-called classical action. It's just the action evaluated on these configurations divided by this superdeterminant. Well, we still have to compute this superdeterminant, and it might be that this is exceedingly hard to do. Because, so what this superdeterminant, so we'll be, we'll see one example, but essentially this superdeterminant amounts to computing the spectrum of a Laplace operator on some manifold and of the Dirac operator on some manifold. This is what usually the kinetic actions are. And of course, in general, if you have generic manifold, we don't know how to compute the Laplace, the spectrum, full spectrum of the Laplace operator and the Dirac operator. However, we will see, after all, we still have supersymmetry, and we still should expect huge cancellations between bosonic modes and fermionic modes. And in fact, as we will see in one example, these huge cancellations do take place. And in fact, one can reduce the computation of the superdeterminant to some cohomological problem, which can be solved, even though we are still not able to find the full spectrum of the Laplacian and Dirac operator on the manifolds. So somehow this will be one hard part of the problem, but there are powerful techniques to compute that. Is there any question? Yes. Oh, okay. Okay.
Only one supercharge to do it.
Sorry?
I mean, do we need only one supercharge?
Yeah, in principle, one supercharge is enough. Of course, this is a formal argument. So first of all, you need one supercharge such that, first of all, you need to find this deformation that satisfies this condition here. Moreover, you need to make sure, I mean, it depends really what the space of BPS configurations is, and now we'll see in one example. So this might be harder or might be simpler. And you also need that there exists some contour in the space of complexified fields where the original path integral is convergent, but also your deformation keeps it convergent. If that is not the case, you can still try to formally compute, but what you get is nonsense. Okay. So now I would like to discuss one example. And, I will not have time to finish this example, but let's try to set the stage. So the first example I want to consider is an old example, a classic example, which is the A twist of the nonlinear sigma model. So this is a very old computation. I thought that for a school this was an appropriate thing to do, to show this old computation. And, I will just sketch the points which are important for me, but in particular I would like to show what are the differences between the results that one can obtain with this old method of the twist and instead the results that one can obtain with more general backgrounds. So my example is a two-dimensional n equal 2 nonlinear sigma model with a twist. Okay, so let me just say what a nonlinear sigma model is, and then on Thursday we start from there. So a nonlinear sigma model is a field theory of maps, phi, from the worksheet, which is our compact two-dimensional surface, to a target, x. In other words, the fields take value on some target manifold, x. So this space is two-dimensional. It's a two-dimensional quantum field theory. However, the fields live on some other manifold, which can have some generic dimension. Let's call it big D. So this is what it is. However, we are interested in supersymmetric version of this theory. So in particular, we would like to consider the n equal 2, 2 version of this theory. And, the nonlinear sigma model contains maps, which are scalars. When we go to a supersymmetric theory, we have to put these scalars into multiplets. And for instance, what we can do is to put them into chiral multiplets. Now, this is not the only way to do that, but I want to consider this very simple case. And so we can put them into chiral multiplets of 0 R charge and 0 central charges. And if you decide to restrict to this restricted class of example, then it turns out that we can preserve this amount of supersymmetry if X is a Keller manifold. In general, this will not be a super conformal theory, it will just be a supersymmetric theory. However, it turns out that this theory is conformal, so it's a super conformal field theory, if X is not just scalar, but is Calabi-Yau, which means that the canonical bundle is trivial, and in particular, there are Ricci flats matrix on this manifold by Yau's theorem. All right. Yeah. So let's stop here and we will do the computation on Thursday.
If you only wanted to preserve n equals 1, supersymmetry 1, 1, then what would be the restriction on x? What would x have to be?
I'm sorry, this nonlinear sigma model?
Yes.
So if you content yourself with 1, 1, any manifold is good. The only thing you have to do is to, so you still have to put these bosons into multiplets. The 1, 1 multiplets contains, so these are complex boson. You put it's probably a Majorana fermion, since it is 1, 1. And that's enough. And so, yes, and there are no restrictions on the manifold, so any manifold will preserve 1, 1 supersymmetry.
But this is known.
Sorry?
This is a known fact.
Yes, I was reminding myself.
Other questions? So, we have now a break, and we come back to the discussion session 5. Thank you very much.